Hey now, good morning, PSW staff, clients, friends, joining us for a lovely Tuesday welcome. Yesterday we looked at the Man of Steel, your foam scrolling assignment, Superman. So get that into me by today. We'll see the results for Friday. It's going to be really fun. Today we're going to look at a composer that I've been wanting to look at because I didn't know that much about him, but I loved certain pieces that I'm going to share with you today. And we're also going to go to a different country. This is going to be really fun on Google Maps, I think. Today we're going to look at the Czech composer, Janáček. I thought it was Janáček, but it's Janáček. Czech composer, music theorist, teacher, publicist, and inspired by Moravian folk music, and created his own original music. And we're going to look at how he did that in a time when it was dominated by German romantic opera music, kind of mostly by Wagner. Wagner was kind of the leader of the mid-19th century romantic period. Let's go over to the Czech Republic. Let's see where it is. Let's leave Hollywood. Don't like to do that, but we need to go and see where these people, there's other places than Hollywood. And we're gonna see where he's born. He's born at 12 children, one of 12. Very poor. His dad taught him music. Let's bring up a timeline. He's born in 1854. So he's going around, when Wagner's writing his operas, the Romantic period's happening, Tchaikovsky's writing music, the Impressionists are coming in with Debussy and Erik Satie, people that we know because we've done classes, of course. 1854 is also the year, this has nothing to do with Janáček, but that the Republican Party's found, the GOP is found. I thought it was way earlier, but I kind of thought that was interesting. That's the same year he's born. The grand old party, the GOP, has started breaking away from the Democratic Party, or the Democratic Republican Party. So, not an American history class. I know that you thought it was, but just thought I'd throw that out there to see what's happening in where we live. But got his musical education from his father, and it was very, very talented and as an organist, as a piano player. In 1874, he enrolls at the Prague Organ School. I mean, to play organ's really tough because you're also using your feet. So using your both arms and both legs to play something. So, but very poor. He couldn't even afford a piano in his room. So he would have a little keyboard, like a paper keyboard drawn to practice, which has got to be so limiting, and it just requires so much discipline. So that's kind of how poor he was. But he did earn his living as a music teacher and a conductor, and started his own conservatory after studying at other conservatories in Vienna and Leipzig. But he wasn't really accepted a lot of places, and he was very outspoken and very critical of other composers, and a pretty kind of stubborn, angry individual person, perhaps. I mean, I never met him, but I mean, that seems like I think he really wanted some fame, some recognition, and he didn't really get that until he was in his 60s. He dies in 1928 from pneumonia at age 74. He's seen a lot of music. If you're thinking, that's romantic music, and then he's seen modern music in the 20th century and jazz music. So anyway, but as he's writing, German music is going on. German romantic music is going on. Now, he likes Tchaikovsky. He does like some Russian-ness. He doesn't, more than the Germans. He writes a lot of operas. And in the 1880s, he finds his voice. How does he find his voice? A lot of it is him going into folk music and finding, you know, we looked at Villa-Lobos going into the mountains, finding musical influences. You know, it's like these guys got training at the conservatory, and then you learn to write like other academics. You learn to write like that. But sometimes you got to go elsewhere to find something original, and you bring it back almost. He's doing this, and he works on something called speech melodies. We looked at speech melodies with Steve Reich a long time ago. You know, it's like as we're talking, those are certain pitches. So he's doing this though in the 1880s, making his melodies sound like the rhythm of language as well. So also the rhythm of how we talk, but also the pitch of how we talk. He becomes friends with Dvorak, another Czech composer, romantic composer, great composer. I was gonna do him today, but I thought we'd talk about Janáček first. In 1901, he writes one of his most famous pieces, On an Overgrown Path. So people described Janáček's music as very short melodic passages sometimes, fast moving motifs, and his flow is not like other composers at the same time. If we think of like somebody like Wagner, it's a long melodic, could be boring, flow. People like Janáček and other composers are gonna not have that flow. They're gonna break pieces up a little bit. We do this all the time today, of course. Over 100 years ago, people weren't doing this in classical music. It wasn't really traditional in the sense. I wasn't sure if I should do that, so I did that. It wasn't really traditional, but he's kind of creating his own style with these kind of, and Poulenc did this too, and we talked about Poulenc, where they were short phrases, and people would maybe consider that undeveloped music. I don't, because I guess because my music is short phrases that aren't developed, and you almost turn that in, hopefully turn that into your own style. What do I mean by that? Like, let's take a look at The Overgrown Path, A Blown Away Leaf. Let's just take a look and listen. You see how lovely and beautiful it sounds. It sounds kind of like Debussy and Erik Satie, right? Very melodic, beautiful solo piano music. But it's only 8 bars. So that whole little thing we just heard is 8 bars. Now, 8 bars is what popular music is all the time, 8 to 12 bars. That's what pop songs are. He's not writing a pop song, but this is breaking away from the tradition of just kind of this wave of classical music where you're not really sure even where the bars are sometimes. It's sounding song-like, and he's an early composer doing this. And this is kind of an early use of minimalism. Of course, we know minimalism is a process of short, melodic, repetitive motifs that Steve Reich and Philip Glass and John Adams do. But he's doing this in, you know, 1900s. He's using short phrases, but they're highly melodic and very beautiful phrases. And that's why we're talking about it, because it's beautiful music. Mm-hmm. So he really didn't get famous till the 60s. I mean, before he was just a conservatory director and at a school that he started. And, he did get recognition through a lot of his operas and, but was an interesting individual. I mean, I first came to love his music from watching the great movie. I love The Unbearable Lightness of Being. I never read the book, but I love the movie. And it's a 1988 drama directed by Philip Kaufman, who directed The Mission, which was our film scoring assignment months ago. They use Kundera, you know, was a Czech writer, and his favorite composer was Jan Hacek. And Philip Kaufman, they use Jan Hacek's music all throughout The Unbearable Lightness of Being. So yeah, I came to know him and love him through a movie. Just wanted to share a little bit of his beautiful music with you. Great composer. Tomorrow we're going to be doing something else. We're going to mix it up a little bit. So hope you enjoyed this little class on his music. And I'm going to be sitting here and waiting for you tomorrow. Okay. Love you, miss you, and have a great rest of the day.